I beg to move the following motion that the current state of the nation, recognizing the state of the nation at this moment, the ongoing protest following the passing of the finance bill, National Assembly Bill number 30 of 2024, on the 25th of June 2024, by the National Assembly, the loss of lives, maiming and loss of property that has been occasioned following this protest, cognizant that pursuant to Article 115(1) of the Constitution, His Excellency the President of the Republic of Kenya declined to assent to the bill and referred it back to the National Assembly with recommendations to delete all clauses of the bill, acknowledging that the conversation on the finance bill has triggered a broader important public conversation on the question of the high cost of living juxtaposed against the wasteful expenditure in all public institutions, including Parliament, further acknowledging the issues raised by the youth and other members of the public to do with corruption, impunity, incompetence within state and public appointments, opulent lifestyles of public officials, unemployment and high cost of living, among other issues bedeviling the economy. Now, therefore, the Senate, one, calls upon the National Assembly to expeditiously consider the presidential memorandum pursuant to Article 115(2)(a), b, all government ministries, departments and agencies and constitutional commissions, including Parliament, to put in place austerity measures in undertaking their respective functions. Three, the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission and other government multi-sector agencies in the governance, justice, law and order sector to upscale and make concerted efforts to fight corruption. D, the National Police Service to cease abductions, unlawful arrest, extrajudicial killings, and exercise restraint in dealing with the peaceful and unarmed demonstrators. E, release of all persons arrested for planning and participating in the peaceful demonstrations relating to the enactment of the finance bill. F, the government to waive hospital bills for persons who have been injured and defray funeral expenses for those who lost their lives during the demonstration. And G, the judiciary to prioritize and expedite all court cases relating to the enactment of the finance bill and resultant demonstration. Two, consider all the challenges facing the country and make necessary recommendations to address them. Mr. Speaker, sir, we are gathered here this morning and I wish to appreciate the fact that before the commencements of the sitting this morning, you led us as a house to, in a minute of silence, reflect and think deeper on the issues that our country faces at this particular moment. And we particularly took time to commiserate and feel the pain and the burden that is with the families and friends of, as per the count of the Kenya National Commission of Human Rights, 39 persons that have so far lost their lives in this going, in the last 2 weeks, Mr. Speaker, as we've had these demonstrations. Mr. Speaker, we acknowledge as a House, and I'd wish to go on record about this, that this is an indictment of us as a leadership in this country, that we are in an extremely difficult place where, if we are not careful, not many countries have gotten to this point and turned back. There are some that 20, 30, 50 years are still trying to turn back, actually, after moments such as this. Therefore, this calls for introspection. This calls for a rethink. This calls for serious empathy on our part as a leader. And I have said this many times on the floor of this House, Mr. Speaker, that the challenges that we face as a country, on many occasions, we have very limited choice. First, in terms of whether to tackle or not, But second and most importantly, on what has been our input as any individual who's in a position of responsibility to get the country to a better space. Therefore, as I begin, Mr. Speaker, I'd wish to personally, and this is at a personal level, not even necessarily as Senator for Kericho, Majority Leader, but just as a leader and somebody who God has granted the opportunity to serve in a position of responsibility in this country, to tender my unreserved apology to the country for either by commission or omission, everything that I have contributed into getting us into the mess and the place that we are in. I have reflected deeply the last few days, Mr. Speaker, and looked through my own journey as an individual and asked myself very serious questions, trying to wear the shoes of the ordinary citizens and how they feel at this particular moment about me as a person. I don't want to focus about any other individual, whichever office they occupy, but just me, a citizen of this country that God in his own wisdom granted the opportunity to serve in a place of responsibility, and try to retrace my steps. What is it that perhaps I should have done better? I have to be sincere, Mr. Speaker, that there were days in the night that I contemplated even quitting and said, perhaps maybe other people can do it. But this is not the time to quit. Because quitting doesn't solve. It doesn't get us out of the hole that you already are in. If it's about getting out and running away, Mr. Speaker, you first sort the mess that you created. I'm afraid, Mr. Speaker, that I know that is the agony that many of our colleagues have thought through. And therefore, just to bring the country up to speed and appreciate why the Senate of the Republic of Kenya is seated this morning, is that we had a session yesterday in the afternoon where we sat down as a Senate of the Republic of Kenya off camera, not in this chamber, but seated somewhere together and reasoned and said, what is it that we can make as our contribution? We are deeply embarrassed, Mr. Speaker, that it has taken young children to point to us that you are naked as our leaders. Extremely troubling. A moment that to many of the people that I listened to yesterday in the afternoon as leaders shared their experiences and what has been the last few weeks, I realized that we are in extraordinary times and ordinary solutions that we have proposed in the past cannot work this time. Unless we are serious, unless we are genuine, unless we are honest, unless we mean it, let us not begin this conversation in this house this morning, Mr. Speaker. And I'd wish to put it on record that I come 100% willing and committed, standing before the Senate and the Republic of Kenya, knowing well that one way or the other, I have made a contribution that I am ready to be persuaded and to be led jointly, first of all, by the leaders that are here and by the things that we are being told by the people that are speaking in the public spaces and the conversation that's going on in the country, Mr. Speaker, on what we need to do to redeem and win back our country so that people can reflect back. And therefore, we have come up with this motion, Mr. Speaker. This is just by the beginning of guiding the country towards solutions. And we'd wish to make a certain number of requests to you as our leader, Mr. Speaker, together with the office of the clerk that is here, that as members will be speaking, let it be known that many of them will take time to paint the state of the nation. That's why we have titled this motion, The State of the Nation, as it is, with no filters, with no embarrassments, Mr. Speaker, pointing and saying things as they are, that this is what is wrong, this is what we hear, and spend the remainder or the latter part of their conversation, Mr. Speaker, in proposing solutions. There are those that we can do within us as Senate. There are those that we can do as a legislature, which is us and the National Assembly. There are things and solutions that we are being asked to make a change at the level of the executive. We will make the recommendation. There are those that constitutionally mandated institutions, Mr. Speaker, have to do. And we have to interact with them and guide, Mr. Speaker, how they do it. Because like I have already pointed out, Mr. Speaker, these are not normal times. And normal solutions will not get us out of this problem at this particular time, Mr. Speaker. Therefore, the request that we make to you is that get us staffers of Parliament who will classify as members speak all these challenges that you are speaking to and cluster them into the various thematic areas so that we deal, we are ready and willing to work whatever time over and above the call of duty, beyond even 6:30, Mr. Speaker, if that is what it will take, because unfortunately, we don't have time. That is the other thing that the young people are telling us. That's the other thing that I hear when I listen to what the country is saying. We are willing and ready to work, Mr. Speaker, so that we classify all these challenges and the various solutions that we are prescribing. Some of them have been suggested by other people outside the precincts of this house. Many others will be shared by these members because there are senior people here. There are people who are experienced. They know what the challenges are, and they know what the contribution can be. Therefore, Mr. Speaker, I want to appreciate the meeting that happened yesterday in the afternoon, where we agreed that not even apportioning blame at this particular time will rescue anybody. When the protesters showed up, Mr. Speaker, in Parliament last week, none of us was spared. And I'd like to say, rightly so. Because much as we may have wished that, oh, deal with the National Assembly, they're the ones who are handling the finance bill, they don't care. They just know that you're leaders. And you're the ones who, by whatever means that is possible, have done this or the other. And therefore, we say that as a Senate, as we begin our reflection in the next few days, as we propose solutions, far-reaching implications, answers to questions that we are being asked as a people in both our private and public spaces, Mr. Speaker, because this conversation has not spared anybody. And it hasn't taken the traditional definitions or characterizations that we know about issues in this country. Nothing to do with religion, nothing to do with the tribe, nothing to do with class, Mr. Speaker. These are unique challenges that have caught over all of us. Mr. Speaker, therefore, we request that when we get our staffers to classify the challenges as they will be enlisted by the various members, say, for example, on the issue of corruption, and this is the proposals that are being made, if our staffers can serve as the rapporteurs, Mr. Speaker, so that later on when we sit to reflect and make our decisions, once we've classified all the issues into the various thematic areas, Mr. Speaker, we will retreat and reconvene as a House, Mr. Speaker, to make the various far-reaching recommendations. Whatever it is that as Parliament we need to do, if it is a change of law, we are willing to do it in record time, Mr. Speaker, and I know we have your cooperation, Mr. Speaker, and you'll help us make that. If it is a resolution of the House specific to the various constitutional commissions and independent office holders, Mr. Speaker, we will make a resolution. Because there are two ways in which Parliament makes decisions, Mr. Speaker. We either vote on a bill or we resolve on a matter and give it as a resolution of the House. We intend to pursue whatever means it will take, Mr. Speaker, to heal the country and make us better as we are being challenged in the last few days, Mr. Speaker. The country is complaining of a broken system, Mr. Speaker, that nothing works. Absolutely nothing. That this is a rigged economy where only those with proximity to power and the advantage unduly given to them by the spaces they occupy, either in public or private institutions, Mr. Speaker, are able to enjoy living in the country. And we are being asked to repair and fix it. Where this thing has reached, Mr. Speaker, it needs an overhaul. I am afraid that not the usual glue and gum that we put into areas that are leaking will solve this time. It's completely broken. If it's a pipeline, Mr. Speaker, it is time to decommission and set up a new pipeline. That's what I hear as being challenged. We are being told that everybody wants a fair shot at life and not our children to get better chances at education. Better chances, Mr. Speaker. I grew through our public education systems from primary to secondary to university, Mr. Speaker. And it was the best at that particular time. People are complaining, Mr. Speaker, that unfortunately, as it is today, nobody with a pen in this country takes their children either to public, primary, secondary, or even university, because it's completely finished, Mr. Speaker. The picture of the primary schools that we all went to, Mr. Speaker, while it served and it worked at that particular time, public education is broken at this time. And we must make radical decision, because, Mr. Speaker, that's what they are speaking to. And they are saying, while you guys are okay, what about the kid of the ordinary person? You know, Mr. Speaker, when every time I lost sleep, as I thought through about the issues that we've been through as a country, Mr. Speaker, I asked myself, where is it that we as leaders have lost touch with reality? I didn't grow up as a child of privilege, Mr. Speaker, for your information. I am 38 years old. I came to this parliament at the age of 29. The first 29 years of my life, I spent them in Eastlands, deep in the slums. I have sold Sim, like these kids you see on our streets in Ngong Road as you drive, Mr. Speaker, and many times when I see them, I reflect back and I roll down my windows and I share with them, because I know that they are complementing what their parents are doing. That's what sends these kids out to the streets. I know what it feels, Mr. Speaker. But why is it that when granted such an opportunity, we are not able to make it better? I believe that an opportunity to serve, Mr. Speaker, and this is what I hear us being told as leaders, an opportunity to serve is to be reminded that we have issues, but we have looked at you and we think you have the wisdom and the ability to make it work for all of us. Can you go and serve? Go and make it possible for the rest of us to enjoy. But unfortunately, either by design or because that is what the country is accustomed to, Mr. Speaker, when you get the first line at the queue, we don't think about the second and the third onwards, Mr. Speaker. We are satisfied that so long as I've had my serving at the table, that will be enough. That's what people are complaining about, Mr. Speaker. And we are here to plead this morning that grant us the opportunity to lead the country as a Senate of Kenya in making the right and the correct decision so that we don't lose our country. I say this at this particular time, Mr. Speaker, so that people may know that in whatever we say, in whatever we do, anarchy is not an option. I'd wish to plead even to those that are leading these protests and demonstrations that if Kenya was to sink, unfortunately, not even them will be spared, Mr. Speaker. And I like the fact that many of the people have begun speaking out and saying that there are certain conditions that you must meet even as a person in some of the solutions that you are prescribing. Because you listen to what is being said in the online spaces, Mr. Speaker, some of the solutions that you can clearly see this will get us into more problems than already we are being unfortunately prescribed on us by people who are not within the borders of Kenya. That's unfortunate, Mr. Speaker. But like I have said, it's not time to apportion blame and point fingers. It is time to lead the country and point them to the right direction. Because what our young people have done is that they have spectacularly, perhaps painted better than Galileo could ever paint, Mr. Speaker, a picture perfect of the reality of what it means to live in the Republic of Kenya today. Nobody could have done it any better, Mr. Speaker. And therefore, it's our duty. We are duty-bound as an institution to lead. Mr. Speaker, corruption has featured prominently in this conversation. In fact, at the heart of it, perhaps finance bill was just but a trigger. But the bigger conversation that the country is having is on the issue of corruption. And what is it that we need to do? We passed the new constitution in 2010, Mr. Speaker, and we thought at that particular time that we had finally succeeded to slay the dragon of corruption, because this is a challenge that as a country we've dealt with the last 60 years or 50, Mr. Speaker. But the question that people are saying is that instead of actually getting better, despite the fact that we have created independent offices, Mr. Speaker, it has become worse. ESCC has crafted, and that's a conversation that we will need to have as a house. And eventually, Mr. Speaker, something that we haven't resolved at this point is, when we have the thematic area, shall we resolve them as a committee of the whole There's a big thinking that says, given the national importance of this conversation, we cannot even relegate it to the committees. There are those that hold a slightly different view, and we will take time to reflect, and I am willing to be persuaded as I listen to my colleagues when they'll be speaking on this issue, Mr. Speaker, whether we deal with it as a committee of the whole. Because we must invite ESCC here, Mr. Speaker. And they must tell us, Mr. Speaker, why is it that we are not succeeding? Is it the law? What is it, Mr. Speaker? What do we need to do as a country? Because what we know for sure is that the system has set up, even this design in our counties, Mr. Speaker, of saying you have an ethics and anti-corruption officer at every county, Mr. Speaker. Basically, what it takes is that they are quickly captured, Mr. Speaker, and they become appendages of the corrupt system in our various counties, Mr. Speaker. The same can be said nationally. And this issue, Mr. Speaker, if we are to be honest, and I wish that the country also indulges us, is that corruption is not only a problem of leaders. It's a national problem. It's a values problem that we have as a people. We cannot just speak, Mr. Speaker, about what leaders are doing without taking time to consider and say, how do we demonetize our politics, Mr. Speaker? How do we make politics less influenced and infiltrated by the power of money, Mr. Speaker? Because unless and until a country has that conversation, Mr. Speaker, I am afraid we are not likely to win this conversation. And part of the proposal that must come out of here, Mr. Speaker, is the process of removing money out of our politics, Mr. Speaker. That has destroyed the fabric of our society. And I like the fact that listening to the president the other day, he said, and this is something that a conversation that many of us have had many times, that even this issue of Harambe is the way it's being done, Mr. Speaker, this presentation of resources, Mr. Speaker, that perhaps it's time to ban it from us as public officials, so that when I go before people, I tell them about policies that I have made to make their life better, not the 2 million shillings that I'm carrying in my car to give them to build a classroom for them, Mr. Speaker. That's a challenge that we must be willing to accept. Because, Mr. Speaker, until, and I must repeat, until we demonetize our politics, Mr. Speaker, and the space of influence, it will continue to be a gold rush and the desire, Mr. Speaker, on every member. You know, people don't know that the cycle of and the life of a politician in this country, it involves running Monday to Thursday, collecting as much as you can, only to go and spend it on Friday to Sunday. And in fact, most of that money, Mr. Speaker, it doesn't even get to the houses of these members. People don't know. If a member makes perhaps a million within a week, they'll be very lucky if 100,000 makes it to do anything in their house. 900 of that money goes back to the constituency. Therefore, we must remove that demand and this desire to see members of parliament and politicians and people in public offices, Mr. Speaker, as if they are tools for pushing resources and money. Until we do that, but that's just the effect. What we need to address here today is a structural fight, and those that are in the justice and Mr. Speaker, law and order society, that they must come here and we must reveal to each other and tell each other, why is it difficult? ESCC must appear before us, Mr. Speaker, and they must tell us this is what we need to do, so that we know, Mr. Speaker, why is it we are now in the third cycle of county governments, Mr. Speaker? Everybody knows why people can almost kill each other to be county governors, Mr. Speaker. But we don't have a solid case, not one, before any courts of law that can point out and say, this is what we have done as an institution. So that people know this is what we are doing. We will be willing, Mr. Speaker, because this has featured prominently. We are being even challenged, Mr. Speaker, as an institution on the things that we have done and said and the laws that we have passed. We must make it difficult. It must pain people, Mr. Speaker, to break the system after we repair it. It must, the punishment must be punitive, Mr. Speaker, so that it gets to a point where people fear. You know, people don't fear to be corrupt in this country because they know what is the worst that will happen. I will be taken to court. I will pay a bail. And I will walk scot-free. Chances are I'll enjoy that money until I die. Yes, he must come to us, Mr. Speaker, and tell us even this new jurisprudence that they are trying to establish, where somebody steals a billion, then says, I am willing to part with 300 million, and we remove the case. Unless we didn't read properly. But, good leaders, I have said, this is not the time to apportion blame. If there are things that they want us to change, is it their budget? Is it the law as we defined it, Mr. Speaker? Let us listen with an open mind and say, tell us what it is that will respond to this particular issue. Mr. Speaker, the judiciary also has been very silent while all this has been going. In fact, the only thing I've seen the Chief Justice speak about was on the issue of abductions, and I think later on when her chambers were raided, she issued a statement or something to that effect. But listening in to what we are being told and the conversation going around, part of the broken system is our judicial system, Mr. Speaker. People know, Mr. Speaker, that even if you are taken to court, you can find your way around it, Mr. Speaker, that you can buy justice. A country that sells its justice, Mr. Speaker, is not a country. If I know that all it takes for me to get away with murder, Mr. Speaker, is sufficient resources in my bank account, then that is not a country. Judicial Service Commission, Mr. Speaker, just like us and all of us that are in positions of responsibility, Mr. Speaker, must engage and be willing to guide us and say this is what has happened. If you listen, as people were speaking, people have shared their experiences, how they have been disinherited of properties that were left by their parents because a rich person showed up, Mr. Speaker, and as orphaned children, they could not put up a fight before our courts of law. That is not the foundation of a judicial system, Mr. Speaker. And we need time to reflect. JSC must tell us, what is it that we need to do, Mr. Speaker? Equal opportunities has featured prominently. Many people are saying, we know that all it will take for you to get unemployment anywhere is to have people of influence. We have constitutionally mandated institutions, Mr. Speaker, NCIC, and so many others. Let's see the studies that they have done so far out of the millions that we have sent to them over the years. Are they just collecting per diems and traveling to Naivasha? Or they have done a scientific study that can help us to appreciate? You know, the problem in this country, Mr. Speaker, is that people love proposing half solutions. And that's what we are being told, that that is not enough. It is not just enough to tell us that this community has this percentage of jobs, this one has the other. Can you make recommendations? And we are willing to come and pass a resolution of the House, Mr. Speaker. If it is established, Mr. Speaker, that the community that I come from has more than an equal share of opportunities, Mr. Speaker, in the various cadres and levels of government, Mr. Speaker, let's pass a resolution here and say that until such a time that others get an opportunity equitably, Mr. Speaker, we don't give chance to those because, but unfortunately, Mr. Speaker, listening and reading the reports that have come from NCIC, it is so basic and it's like the person who designed it just wanted to appease people with little facts here and there, Mr. Speaker. Oh, Kikuyus have this percentage, Luos have the other. That's not enough. Break it down. Work like a serious institution. Tell us how many CEOs exist in public service. Give us their distribution. How many senior level managers exist? How many are ordinary clerks, Mr. Speaker? We could be talking about a particular community that has a certain share, Mr. Speaker, but they are all clerks and drivers. It's not the same. We need a more detailed study so that you lead us as a house into making this conversation. I'm trying to rush, Mr. Speaker, because I know time is not on our side. Governance on our value systems, Mr. Speaker, featured prominently in this conversation. And we must put it either by law, by design. What is it that you do as a public official when certain things are said about you? How is it, Mr. Speaker, that in certain countries, that you as a public official, even when you are just accused of having an extramarital affair, forget about stealing public resources. The system is so advanced that you are challenged and are told, Mr. XYZ, if you cannot be faithful even to your partner, you cannot be faithful to your current to the country, that your character has been found wanting. And people are asked to step aside on such occasions, and people do the honorable thing and say, I think I no longer enjoy the trust of the people. Allow me to pursue other things. On personal matters, I'm not talking about public issues, Mr. Speaker. The problem with us is even when we have been challenged on public issues, Mr. Speaker, we still want to stick and die until, you know, the famous quote that somebody once said, I'd rather die than resign. On that, Mr. Speaker, I have a certain level of reprieve as a person, but it still doesn't help me. Like I said, these young people don't care, and the people that are speaking don't care, because on the two occasions that the debt question appeared before this house, the last term, I voted against it, both to move it at 6 trillion and eventually when we moved it to 10 trillion, Mr. Speaker. But that doesn't help. That's history. We can point fingers and say, you moved, you did this or the other. It doesn't matter at this point. The thing we are being told first, Mr. Speaker, is that when Kenyans look keenly, they are trying to locate 10 trillion in the country and they cannot see it. So they're asking, are you sure, first of all, that we owe 10 trillion? And I have made public confessions, Mr. Speaker. Those that served with us in the Budget and Finance Committee last time, Mr. Speaker, know that when we asked for Kenya's debt register, it was brought to us on an Excel sheet. No records beyond that. And you're being told, company this, you owe them this much, this is the rate at which you borrowed, and so on and so forth. It pointed out to a problem. In fact, on the day that I made my contribution and said that I reject this approval of the debt, raising of the debt ceiling to 10 trillion, that's part of the reasons that I raised that afternoon, Mr. Speaker. And I said, until Parliament has a counter copy of what the Treasury is borrowing, Mr. Speaker, and we rearrange that whole space of our debt, Mr. Speaker, we are not yet out of the woods. Therefore, I don't want to spend a lot of time on the issue of debt, Mr. Speaker, but we are being told that a public audit of our debt situation, Mr. Speaker, is mandatory at this particular point. And I know the executive will do this, but even us as Parliament, because it's us who failed in that regard, we must carry out our own, so that we countercheck with what the executive is doing. Parliamentary Budget Office can lead this exercise, but if they need the expertise of other audit firms, including international reputable established institutions that can help us in this conversation, people who know about multilateral lending, Mr. Speaker, and going to the financial markets, because there are issues of Eurobond there in and other institutions that we have borrowed from, Mr. Speaker, let us have that conversation so that we know, first of all, Mr. Speaker, what is our debt exposure. Look at even the debt ceiling change of law that we did earlier. Makes sense. We argued and said we want to change how we calculate our debt status, Mr. Speaker, as opposed to having it as a static number, make it as a percentage of the GDP, because that's a more globally accepted standard. And that's fine. And I supported that motion, Mr. Speaker. And we said in 3 years' time, we want to bring our debt sustainability to 55% of the GDP. It is now at 61. We have 3 years. But what is the plan, Mr. Speaker? What did we learn from the past? How comes when you are passing that particular legislation, we didn't tie it so neatly so that we know? You know, bringing debt as a percentage to the GDP to 55% is not an occurrence, Mr. Speaker. It's not an event. It's a process. You have to grow down your fiscal deficit over the years. We didn't put it in law, Mr. Speaker. And it's not just enough for us to be satisfied and say that we have a promise that in 3 years' time, that's where we'll be. At the time of exiting this conversation, Mr. Speaker, we must tighten that law so that even as those that do our budget at the Treasury know that the maximum fiscal deficit that we can get for this year 2024-2025 is this one, and you tighten it so that by 20 you leave them with no option, so that by 2027, Mr. Speaker, when you're supposed to be at 55%, they have no option but to get there. But if we leave the law as it is, I can tell you for a fact that we will get to 2027, we will still be at 60, Mr. Speaker, or even more if we don't change. And we must make a decision, Mr. Speaker, as we sit and reflect, because debt has featured prominently in this conversation. As I move to conclude, Mr. Speaker, SRC, Salaries and Remuneration Commission, have been silent as this whole debate has been raging. Silence is not an option anymore, Mr. Speaker. They have to speak to the country. They have to tell us what is it that you're going to do so that we reduce our public expenditure on wages and salaries from 46% to the mandatory 35%, Mr. Speaker. If it means taking a pay cut, we as members of parliament, Mr. Speaker, good people, we have been told that it's not possible, that members of parliament will never do it. We don't have an option. We must do it, Mr. Speaker. The yearly increment that is now being discussed, that we are being told that, I saw that being reported or misreported in sections of the media, that we are now going to earn more. SRC continues to be silent about it, but we must make a resolution and say we reject even that one in light of the financial situation. But as it is, Mr. Speaker, even if the high earners were to take a shave on their salary, that is still not enough. I don't have the statistics, and that's why I've said some of these constitutional commissions have failed us, Mr. Speaker. I don't know what would be the percentage of Kenyans say that earn over and above 100 and 150. But I'm certain, Mr. Speaker, they are in the slim minority of less than 10%. 90% of our public officers earn less than 100,000 and below, Mr. Speaker. And therefore, whatever savings that we can make there, let us make. But over and above, the thing that people don't like, Mr. Speaker, and this featured prominently. Senator Omogeni is out, but he knows this featured prominently in our NADCO talks. And a report that we tabled here, Mr. Speaker, unfortunately, which we haven't done with speed, Mr. Speaker, captured all the wastages that are in the public expenditure space and what we need to do as a country. From page 546 of the NADCO report, I think, to almost page 600, Mr. Speaker, where things that we understand, things are tight. It's the most obvious thing that people do. Young people are telling us, when you have a job with Safaricom, you can live in Langata. But the day you lose that job, you move downwards to either to South B or Moja until things get better. That's what we are not able to do as a leadership. We know for a fact that when things were better, we could all fly business as members of parliament. But if you read the recommendation from NADCO, we have said any flight that is less than 3 to 4 hours, surely, must you fly business as a public official? 3 hours. You will not even sleep. You know? And so many things, Mr. Speaker, recurrent expenditure and wastages. Institutions, even parliament. And you know, I saw our staff criticize us and say, yes, we have been saying this or the other. But even our staffers, they need to know that this must come to them. You know, I've served as staff welfare chair, so I know a thing or two about expenditure in this institution. You will hardly get anybody in parliament, Mr. Speaker, on a Friday. Even to consider a report on something that happened in parliament, Mr. Speaker, people cannot consider it in parliament. It must be considered in Naivasha or Mombasa, as is the case in all our public institutions. We must lead by example, Mr. Speaker. And before we exit out of this motion today, we must give a blow-by-blow detail and say, what is it? What happens? Why is it that people cannot think in public offices on Fridays? That there must be somewhere in Naivasha, there must be somewhere in Kisumu, there must be elsewhere, Mr. Speaker. I don't think that there is any correlation between better consideration of a tender document or evaluation exercise that comes when you leave Nairobi, Mr. Speaker. These are extraordinary times, Mr. Speaker, and I must appreciate that there has been guidance, Mr. Speaker, and we are being reminded that because the finance bill has now been sent back via presidential memorandum and all clauses have been deleted. You know, that's a space that many people misunderstand, and sometimes we need to help people also appreciate parliamentary procedures. Number one, finance bill remains to be a bill. It's not an act of parliament Like many people have seen misreported in public spaces and says, oh, it takes effect on such and such a day. But as a sign of goodwill and trust, because trust has been completely eroded at this time, Mr. Speaker, I think the wise thing to do is for the National Assembly to come. The Budget and Finance Committee considers that recommendation immediately, Mr. Speaker, so that people are satisfied that that is behind us. But having done that, of more importance, the National Treasury must table the new budget estimates that captures, Mr. Speaker, the new reality. Less 3.9 trillion, less the 346 that was lost. And people must take a cut. In fact, my proposal, Mr. Speaker, it's a very simple exercise. 346 out of 3.9 trillion budget, Mr. Speaker, is 9%. At least at the national level, because I wouldn't wish that the same be applied to our counties. For counties, it must be on equity basis, Mr. Speaker. But on government, national government institutions, just to a prorata cut. If your budget was 300 billion, Mr. Speaker, as a state department or an agency, you submit your new estimates less than 9% so that you are left to go and do the reappropriation of whatever needs to be done. And by next week, Mr. Speaker, we have a new budget that captures that particular reality, because, like we are being reminded, living within our means is not an option anymore. And I believe that when our colleagues reconvene in the National Assembly, they'll be guiding us in that particular. But I have to be specific and say, because in the first instance, the distribution to counties was not pro rata, then the shave, I don't know what is being proposed, and we will wish to be reasoned, but it cannot be pro rata to counties, Mr. Speaker. We must, at the very least, I know it's not in my place, but at the very least, Mr. Speaker, counties should not get less than what they got last year. At the very least, Mr. Speaker, I know it's difficult, but somehow, somewhere, we must protect. Though, members, I don't know if you follow this conversation, even in our own county level, people have become more critical in budget-making process, and they are beginning to ask our county governors, can you lay out your budget in public so that we see also where is your confidential vote, like there was. You know, there are many budget lines that people don't follow. But now people are becoming more alive to reality of the budget-making process in our counties. And we'll speak later, I'm sure, when colleagues speak, they will get time. I cannot say everything. To say on also the architecture of devolution, whether as is presently moving, Mr. Speaker, whether it can work. You know, Mr. Speaker, you are governor. Between 2013 and 2017, many young people, women, and the vulnerable made a life out of doing business with counties. And there was spread of resources within, you know, in every village, you could see a young person and you'd be told so and so. He's a road contractor, he supplies this and the other. He trades with the county, and therefore people could begin to appreciate. These are things that were completely unknown to the country before the promulgation of the new constitution. Post-2017, there are no such people in our villages, Mr. Speaker. In fact, I have said on the floor of this house many times that unless the governor is your personal friend, or sometimes even unless he's your father, nobody can dare supply to our counties anymore. Nobody can dare trade with them. As protectors and custodians of devolution, Mr. Speaker, the house charged with the responsibility to make sure that devolution works in our county. Before we exit this motion, we must propose a way forward. If it means forcing our governors to first clear all the pending bills that have been found to be eligible, Mr. Speaker, before rolling out any new development, so that you give life at least to the many women and young people, Mr. Speaker, that have lost whatever little savings that they had by trading with counties, Mr. Speaker, we must pass that particular resolution today, Mr. Speaker. On the issue of police, I just want to speak to two final issues, then I conclude. I once said in a public forum, I was asking, where is the IG? That was in relation to the killings that were going on in Kerio Valley. It's been 2 weeks of protests, Mr. Speaker. Kenyans have lost their lives. Others have been beaten. There have been challenges. Police have faced also very difficult and hostile gangs on the streets. I am yet to hear the voice of the Inspector General. I am deeply troubled by that, Mr. Speaker. It cannot be right. We were in this country, though I was not a leader and I was a young person in university, Mr. Speaker, when we faced the post-election violence, day by day, General Hussein Mohammed will brief the country and speak to the country and give them an update of what is happening. How can we face such a crisis, Mr. Speaker? Up to this particular point, I don't know what the Inspector General thinks. I don't know what is the challenge. We don't know these things that are being discussed. Mr. Speaker, the question at the back of my mind, is this really the right man for this job? Mr. Speaker, we must think critically, finally, about Article 37. We have had conversations and debates here on this House. Were the demonstrations peaceful or not? How is it that we continue to struggle as a country with this thing of peaceful demonstrations? What is it that we are supposed to do? Can't we guide and provide the way forward so that people can know that if I want to peacefully demonstrate as expected of me, under rights guaranteed under my constitution, what is it that we are supposed to do? Because a new trend is emerging, and we have seen this, Mr. Speaker, where any time when you organize a demonstration, infiltration and separating between those that are peacefully protesting, Mr. Speaker, and those that want to take advantage of the environment and the climate that has been created is difficult to distinguish. And I'd wish to request the House that we don't exit on this motion until first we provide the way forward and guidance. I listened, for example, Mr. Speaker, to one gentleman, one of the organizers of the Occupy Parliament crusade, and he said, according to them, they just wanted to come and sit outside here and listen and make noise as the debate on the finance bill was ongoing. And I said, okay, fair enough. But unfortunately, in the way that they communicated, it was impossible to tell how to do that kind of an occupation. I wish, Mr. Speaker, at that point, that there had been an engagement either with your office, because you're the person who permits this kind of engagements, so that we know how is it that if today there are 100,000 people who want to come and present a public petition to Parliament, we should be able to facilitate it, so that they know what time they'll come, how, what they want to do, so that we set the rules and agree, and people know, and we don't provide an environment or a climate that is ripe for people with sinister motives, Mr. Speaker. I know for a fact that it was not the design of the young people that wanted to protest outside Parliament for Parliament to look like it looks this afternoon. They had no intention of banning anything. I don't think it was in their design to destroy the amount of property that has been destroyed here. I don't think it was in their design, Mr. Speaker, for members to flee for their life. They wanted to come and present a petition. Therefore, we have to think and propose as a way forward of how is it that we can guarantee every citizen how we protect their rights, because there are two inherent dangers, Mr. Speaker. If we don't provide a way forward and a way out of this particular conversation, then it shall be known forever, Mr. Speaker, that it is impossible to have a peaceful protest in this country, yet other countries have it. When we travel, even, anyway, I don't want to get into a diplomatic challenge by mentioning various countries, Mr. Speaker, but there are countries that you think even are less democratic, but they have provided the space and the means for people to exercise their democratic right on the right to peaceful protest, Mr. Speaker, and it's provided for, and people make their voice heard. I don't know how we can do it. I know colleague members can guide us on how this is done, but the long and short of this conversation, Mr. Speaker, is that we are sick, and the ordinary medicine that we have administered over the years is not likely to heal us. We need new medication, Mr. Speaker. Therefore, with those many remarks, Mr. Speaker, I beg to move and request the leader of minority, Senator Justice retired Stewart Mazayo, to second this motion, Mr. Speaker, and lead the country towards the right path. I thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Bwana Speaker, cha kwanza ningependa kuunga mkono hoja hii. Mswada huu naunga mkono kwa sababu unakuja katika wakati unaofaa. Bwana Speaker, nasimama hivi leo hapa ndani ya bunge la Senate nikiwa na majonzi makubwa sana. Tukiwa na majonzi sisi kama bunge la Senate kwa sababu hivi sasa Kenya imeweza kupoteza maisha ya watoto wa Kenya 39. Na vile vile tukiangalia katika mahospitali yetu yote katika Kenya, kuanzia sekta zote katika Kenya, kama ni kuanzia baharini mpaka Lake Victoria, kuanzia ukumbi wa magharibi mpaka mashariki, Kenya nzima katika kila mahospitali kuna watu ambao wameketi huko sasa nambari 361 ambao wameweza kufanyiwa matibabu, wengine wamekatwa maguu, wengine wamekatwa mikono, wengine wamefanyiwa operation za tumbo, vichwa. Hivi sasa wako na majanga ya maumivu wakiwa wamelala katika hizo hospitali. Bwana Speaker, ni jambo la kusikitisha sisi kama bunge tukiwa hapa kuona kwamba nchi yetu inaenda njia ambayo sio. Na kunao muhimu zaidi kuweza kuona ya kwamba tumeweza kuregesha nchi, imeenda katika njia inayofaa. Bwana Speaker, kitu cha kwanza, tuko na vijana. Vijana katika Kenya ambao ni vijana wadogo, vijana mabarubaru ambao wao ni Gen Z. Hao vijana mabarubaru, Bwana Speaker, wamekuja barabarani, wamekuja kwenye maandamano wakiwa wao wako na chupa za maji, wameshika katika mkono wao wa kushoto na upande wa kulia wameshika simu ili kuweza kurekodi ile historia ambao wamekuja barabarani wakifanya maandamano wakidai haki za kila Mkenya ziweze kutendeka. Bwana Speaker, hawa vijana wa Gen Z hawana ukabila, hawana ujamaa, hawana undugu. Wao wanajuana kama Wakenya. Wao wanajuana kama Wakenya ambao ni ndugu moja, ni watu wanaishi pamoja, ni watu nchi yao ni hii Kenya, na hata Kenya ikiharibika hawana nchi nyingine ambao watakimbilia. Kwa hiyo wamekuja kutengeza historia na kurekodi historia kwa sababu wanadai haki zao. Bwana Speaker, jambo la kusikitisha, tunaona kwamba polisi ambao ni utumishi kwa wote wakiongozwa na Inspector General Koome walitumia nguvu kupita kiasi kuweza kusimamisha maandamano haya ambayo yalisababisha vifo, ambayo yalisababisha watu kuumia. Hivi sasa tunavyoongea kuna watu pengine wamekatwa miguu, wamekatwa mikono, tumbo zao hazijulikani kama watapona namna gani. Na kufikia sasa, Bwana Speaker, ni jambo la kusikitisha. Na mimi nataka kusema ya kwamba wazee wote, wakina mama, poleni sana. Sisi kama bunge la Senate tuko pamoja na nyinyi katika barabara hii. Na tunaendelea kusupport hao vijana kwa sababu ya kwamba maandamano yao yako katika sheria na yako ndani ya katiba. Bwana Speaker, nataka kusema ya kwamba inajulikana kiwazi sababu ya haya maandamano. Bwana Speaker, sababu ya haya maandamano yaletwa kwa sababu ya ile bili ama ule mswada wa fedha. Mswada wa fedha ulikuwa na mahesabu ambayo yalikuwa si sawa. yalikuwa yanaweza kutoza ushuru wananchi ambao umepita kiasi. Bwana Spika, tunajua kwamba ushuru ni haki ya kila mwananchi aweze kulipa. Lakini ushuru ukipita kiasi ama mambo ambayo hayafai kutozwa ushuru yakiwekwa hapo, ni lazima watu waweze kuandamana ili kupata haki yao. Bwana Spika, tunaona kabisa ya kwamba hii bili ya fedha ama huu mswada wa fedha uliweza kuleta mushkili mkubwa sana ndani ya nchi yetu ya Kenya. Na sisi hatuwezi kulaumu wale vijana wa Gen Z kwa sababu walipokuja walisema ya kwamba mswada huu unagandamiza kila mwananchi. Haugandamizi tajiri peke yake, haugandamizi maskini peke yake, bali unagandamiza kila mtu katika nchi. Bwana Spika, sisi kama viongozi tunasema ya kwamba ni lazima tuwe na nidhamu. Tuwe na nidhamu kwa sababu Bwana Spika, tunaona ya kwamba hivi wananchi wanavyoendelea kuishi hawaishi katika maisha mema. Maisha yamekuwa ghali na kila kitu katika Kenya kimekuwa hakiwezi kupatikana kirahisi. Jambo ambalo nataka kusema zaidi ni kwamba kumezuka ile sehemu ya watu kuwa na majivuno. Wale watu ambao wanajivunia sana ni wale watu ambao wanafanya ufisadi. Bwana Spika, tumeona katika harakati za wale wa Kenya ambao juzi jana tulikuwa pamoja, hivi leo watu hawajamaliza miaka miwili ndani ya hili bunge, tunaona ya kwamba watu maisha yao yamegeuka. Wamekuwa matajiri zaidi ya vile inavyokana. Bwana Spika, utajiri huu ambao unaupata kighafla, kama ambaye umechukua ndege unaruka juu unakuwa tajiri mara moja na dakika 45 unashuka chini umefika Mombasa, ni hali ya aibu. Na mambo kama haya ambayo tunaonyeshana, mambo ya kusikitisha. Kenya yetu inataka iwe na amani. Wako watu wanaishi. Tuliona hata yule balozi wa Uingereza alisema sasa watu wamekuja hivi karibuni walikuwa hawana kitu. Sasa wamekuwa matajiri mpaka wanatutapikia. Hii ndio tunaona ya kwamba Gen Z wanasema hii aibu kama hii isitendeke katika nchi yetu. Kwa hiyo Bwana Spika, sisi tunasema tu ya kwamba vile ambavyo rais aliweza kukataa kusaini na karegesha, ni kwamba huo ulikuwa mwelekeo wa kisawasawa. Anataka kusema ya kwamba wale ambao wamepoteza maisha yao, Bwana Spika, waweze kupewa na waweze kwa serikali iweze kuangalia kwa wale wote ambao walikuwa wamepatikana hasara hiyo katika maandamano haya. Bwana Spika, sisi kama bunge la Senate tuko tayari wakati wote. Hawa Gen Z wakiwa wanataka kutuona, sisi kama bunge la Senate tuko tayari. Wao waseme ni wapi na mahali gani, sisi tuko tayari, tunaweza kuketi nao. Hakuna wakati bunge letu hili la Senate limeahirishwa kwa sababu hatutaki kuonana na wananchi. Hapana. Hata wakati wa vita mabunge yote katika ulimwengu huwa yanabaki yakisikiza wananchi, kwa sababu mabunge ndio yanaelekea yanaweza kutekeleza mwelekeo wa taifa. Na hivi sasa sisi tuko tayari. Tunasema poleni sana kwa wale ambao walikuwa walipatikana katika hii hasara ya maandamano, na kwa wale vijana wote Gen Z, bunge la Senate liko wazi. Wakati wowote wakitaka kuonana na sisi, sisi kama bunge la Senate tuko tayari kukutana nao. Bwana Speaker, la mwisho nataka kusema ya kwamba kwa sababu nimetangulia kusema kwamba kuna watu ambao hivi sasa wamelala katika mochari ambao ni 39 katika ile ratiba ya hesabu, na pia kunaweza kuwa pengine kuna wengine zaidi katika pande zote za Kenya mbalimbali, na wale ambao wameumia, tunasema kwamba wale mapolisi ambao walitumia nguvu zao, walitumia bunduki badala ya kutumia ile bunduki ambao unatupa kile kikebe cha kutoa machozi, waliweza kutumia bunduki zile ambazo ziko na risasi na kupiga hao wananchi ambao walifariki. Tunasema ya kwamba hao polisi hatua lazima ichukuliwe na washikwe, waweze kupelekwa kotini, wachajiwe na makosa ya kutumia bunduki ama kutumia nguvu zaidi na kuumiza wananchi ama kupoteza maisha yao. Kitu cha pili, nataka kusema kwamba wale wote ambao wameshikwa wako ndani hivi sasa, wameshikwa kiholela, aidha kutolewa katika gari kama vile tuliona yule mbunge wa zamani alivyotolewa, tunasema ya kwamba wale wote ambao hivi sasa wamewekwa ndani korokoroni kwa makosa haya ya kuandamana tu, tunasema ya kwamba hao watu wawachiliwe mara moja. Nataka kuuliza rais ambaye ana uwezo yeye kama rais na aliyeweza kuandika hao watu katika serikali yake, kuna watu wako na record za ufisadi, kuna watu wamefanya vitendo ambavyo havifai kulingana na sheria za Kenya, ile tunaita katika criminal acts. Ikiwa hao watu wako katika serikali yako, afadhali awaachishe kazi mara moja. Vile vile tunasema ya kwamba jambo lingine ni kwamba ile bili ya IBC hivi sasa ambayo iko kwenye mikono yake, iko katika mikono ya rais, ako nayo, kuondoa hili vuguvugu la kwamba hutaki kusaini ama huwezi kusaini ama kuna tashwishi yoyote. Wananchi hivi sasa wanataka hiyo IEBC iwekwe ndani, ikuwe sheria mara moja, ili mambo ya Kenya yaweze kuendelea kulingana na uchaguzi katika yale maeneo ambayo hayana wabunge ama hayana wale watu wanaowakilisha. Kwa hiyo aiweke kidole mara moja. Kuna wale walimu wa JSS na wale madaktari ambao wanamaliza, ambao wamepita mitihani yao, hawa ni lazima waandikwe mara moja. Na mwisho pia ile program ambayo ilikuwa inasaidia watoto wa watu wasiojiweza maskini kama school feeding program, hiyo iregeshwe mara moja ili watoto waweze kuenda skuli wakijua watapata chakula. La mwisho lakini la mwisho na muhimu zaidi ni kwamba sisi kama wabunge wa Senate, nakubaliana na alivyosema kiongozi walio wengi, vile watu wanasema kwamba ati mishahara inaongezwa, Bwana Speaker, mimi nasema kwamba sitaki mshahara wangu uongezwe. Bao ulikuwa sisi tupewe kama wabunge wa Senate, na najua ndugu zangu maseneta wako hapa, tuna shida za pesa ndio, lakini nina hakika watakubaliana na mimi ya kwamba si wakati mzuri sasa sisi kuongezwa mishahara. Haifai, hatuitaki, tumekataa. Ndugu yangu Khalwe, utakubaliana na mimi ya kwamba ushakula chumvi ya kutosha. Mshahara hivi sasa ukae kando, wapewe wale ambao hawajiwezi ili waweze kuendelea na maisha yao sawa sawa. Ama ile pesa ambayo ingepewa katika mishahara ipelekwe kwa hawa ambao walipata majeruhi, wale ambao wamefariki, wale ambao wako na shida zao ziende huko ili ziweze kuwasaidia. Bwana Speaker, huu ni mswada ambao uko na maana sana. Na sisi tunajua tunaita uwiano, tunajua sote ni wa Kenya. Kenya ikiharibika itakuwa ni nchi yetu. Hatuna nchi nyingine ya kwenda isipokuwa kubaki hapa ndani ya Kenya. Kwa hiyo tunatakiana kila laheri kuona kwamba serikali yetu na watu wetu wa Kenya tumekaa pamoja kama ndugu moja, tuwe na amani, tupendane, tuweze kurejesha nchi yetu katika njia ya amani na mwelekeo. Asante sana Bwana Speaker. Naunga mkono.
Mr. Speaker, accept my compliments for allowing us to reserve time and place for this very important motion. And Mr. Speaker, allow me to equally compliment the leader of the majority and the leader of my minority for speaking not just from their minds, but especially from their hearts. I never thought in my life that in this house I would listen to the wonderful speech by the young Senator Aaron Keriot. We have been trying to steer this parliament in that direction, and some people wanted to read defiance. No. Listen to the words of the leader of the minority. He is telling the Gen Z that at no time in this parliament have we ever locked anybody from accessing us. They didn't have to lose lives, lose limbs, result in loss of property for them to have an opportunity for a photo session in this house. Every day, the Speaker's Gallery and the Public Gallery has not only remained open, but it always have people. In fact, there are times, Mr. Speaker, when we are not sitting, the Sergeant at Arms allows people to come and sit in these benches. We didn't have to pay this price. Mr. Speaker, I therefore want to open my remarks by passing my profound, heartfelt condolences to all Kenyans who lost their lives, who were injured, and whose property was destroyed. Mr. Speaker, I specifically missed to sit in this house on Wednesday last week, when I should have, because a woman who has been selling me fried groundnuts and oranges in Kakamega, Caroline Shiramba, was shot dead. She sells outside the office of the governor. Mr. Speaker, equally here in Nairobi, a young man from Malinya was shot dead. So these things have come very close. And for those who thought that this was something for a particular set of Kenyans, when I went to visit the victims at the General Hospital in Kakamega, one of the victims was the son of one of my chiefs. He was at the forefront in Kakamega. You saw, even the son of the Attorney General of Kenya was also involved. I saw the son of Honorable my brother, Junjuri, was involved. I particularly don't know where my children were. Probably they were also involved. The only thing that missed was that they were not captured on camera. Mr. Speaker, where are we? 3-4 things that are unprecedented have taken place. The first one is that for the first time in the history of this country, the president refused to assent to the finance bill. It is unprecedented. 2, Mr. Speaker, the youth did what they did. Some people call it inversion of parliament. Others call it desegregation of parliament. I don't know what to call it. I can only say they did what they did. Mr. Speaker, never in the history of the 4 presidents we have had in this country have they ever contemplated on deploying the military the way we did. Mr. Speaker, Finally, you saw across the whole country members of the public touching homes and properties of elected leaders. We are indeed in a bad place, and therefore, as we say in our community, when you are mourning, you don't mourn with shame. We must speak to it, as I wish to do now. Mr. Speaker, we are where we are today because Kenyans hate and are angry with the ongoings in the country. And if we don't speak to them and take action, we will go nowhere. It was never the finance bill. It was simply that the finance bill was a trigger. Why? Because public servants, led by ministers, are very, Mr. Speaker, corrupt. And people hate this, and people are angry. Yesterday, colleagues, I was called by a minister whose name I don't wish to bring on the floor because it's not necessary. And he was very angry with me for the position that I have taken, especially over the weekend in Nabakholo, over corruption in the cabinet. He told me very many strong and bad things. Because people who the other day we were walking with here want to think because the Constitution has given them a different office as opposed to the offices as ourselves we have been given, they are therefore in high heaven, they should be worshipped. Nobody should mention their name, even when they are wrong. Mr. Speaker, people are angry and hate public servants because of our own making. The public display of wealth and opulence, unless members of the public can quickly see where you've gotten it, they will not be happy. Over the weekend, I was speaking of a young member of parliament from my community who has bought a helicopter. And I know him very well. I wish him well to continue accumulating wealth. I wish him well to continue accumulating wealth. But please, I'm asking the president to ask himself, how can the membership of an MP to a committee of parliament be the basis for him to be able to afford some of the things that are not affordable? Honorable Didmus Baraza, take it easy. Those helicopters will not change your life. Mr. Speaker, I equally offended somebody whose name I never mentioned in Kakamega over the weekend about this issue of opulence. I just wondered, how would an MP be able to donate 20 million shillings at a harambee? He was very offended. In another function, I saw a minister of this government carrying a white bag on the back like this and started announcing how many millions are in that bag. Said, moja, mbili. No. Mr. Speaker, if we don't refuse these things, people like Murkomen will think that they are giving us their money. It's not their money. Those are proceeds of corruption. This house is saying no. Because of that anger, look at what our children did. Mr. Speaker, people are angry and hate us as leadership because every weekend, helicopters, they crisscross the skies all of them going to functions where these millions are being dished. Mr. Speaker, the fuel guzzlers that we drive, I know if you go to this parking, Mr. Speaker, you can see the difference between the vehicle four-wheel drive driven by your senators compared to those ones driven by members of the National Assembly. In the parking of the Senate, you see Prados. But in the parking of the National Assembly, you see high-end vehicles that sometimes you only see. And why, Mr. Speaker? Because of an unconstitutional fund called CDF. That unconstitutional fund, the courts made a pronouncement that it was unconstitutional and illegal. How did we respond as Parliament? The National Assembly, without blinking an eye, went and exercised legislative impunity by twisting the act so as to be allowed to continue with that unconstitutional, illegal process. Mr. Speaker, as I speak to these guzzlers, you have seen colleagues. You are there struggling to rush to this Senate, then an MP, then a Secretary General of a political party comes with chess cars, his vehicle having the national flags with a siren, and the police does not arrest those people. The law is very clear on who should actually fly the national flag. The law should be very clear on whose convoy should be cleared with sirens. This is the impunity that is making our young people to turn against us. Mr. Speaker, I want to celebrate the President for the remark he made on Sunday during the interview that he was fielding questions. I did not support the fact that the President was fielding questions. I did not. Because I know that the President has people who are supposed to have failed those questions. As like the leader of the majority was saying, the responses to security that the President was doing should either have been done by regular briefs by the IG or by Professor Kithure Kindiki. What was the President being put there being humiliated by the people of the media? But I'm celebrating for accepting that we have wasteful expenditure in several offices in this country. Professor respected Githu Muigai gave, while in office, a legal advisory opinion on something called the Office of the First Lady. I urge you, colleagues, to go and read that opinion. He convinced me, and those who will read it after me, that the issue of First Lady is actually foreign to our constitution. As if it's not enough, we had not only have the office of the First Lady, wife of the President, gobbling millions of shillings, we also have another one for the office of the wife of the Deputy President, another one for the office of the wife of the Prime Cabinet Secretary, another one for the office of the governors. I always say, God bless Kenya. If I had that ambition, then if I were to ascend to one of these offices that people think they should have those wives as first ladies. You would shake my family. Who will be my wife? Who will be the first lady? Will be the my first wife, my second wife, my third, which one? Those are private family issues that should never be brought in public. I am a student of Michael Kijana Wamalwa. I am a student of George Welima Captain. I never saw Wamalwa's wife or George Welima's captain's wife address any function, not in Luya Land, not in their constituencies, nowhere else. Their purpose was to make sure that visitors have eaten. What became of husbands in this country? Mr. Speaker, very quickly, because the light is now on, people are angry and hate us because of impunity. The impunity you are seeing, that we have a director of public prosecutions who, from Monday to Friday, sits scheming on which language and which law to use so as to help people who are politically correct, criminals who are, have court cases, to be released. I don't know if that is why. I don't know if that is why we separated the office of the Attorney General from the office of the Director of Public Prosecution and made it an independent office. Not only from Kakamega, but the DPP is my sister's son from Malinya there. That it's not necessary. Let criminals who have stolen property, and you know them, go through the due process. If it was working, some of the ministers in office today would not be ministers. They became ministers because a corrupt parliament allowed them to become ministers, and then the DPP followed it up by withdrawing their cases. Mr. Speaker, impunity of tribalism. Leader of the majority, you have said it. Where will the children from the tribes where the president does not come from, where deputy president does not come from, where the prime cabinet secretary does not come from, how will they get jobs? Mr. Speaker, they hate us because of the impunity of nepotism. I know of a cabinet secretary who has employed in his office two sons of, yes, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the impunity, shooting members of the public dead, and they are set free. And we say we are living in a country of rule of law. Mr. Speaker, there is anger and hatred because the government is unable to fix this monster called CBC system. That system has killed free primary education. That system has destroyed the quality of education. For many years, my children have been doing the exam at Malinya Primary School, all of them. It's only right now that for the first time, my daughter, Sonia Inuni Khalwe, is now in class 7 junior secondary in a private school, because at Malinya Primary School, where we all went to, all my children and myself, it has collapsed. There are two teachers in a class of 150. Teaching our children of the poor. So there's no learning going on, colleagues. Mr. Speaker, there is anger and hatred because of the insensitivity of this parliament. We are so insensitive that when the issue of housing levy was raised, we did not respond critically. Allow me just to conclude. Wait, Mr. Speaker, can I?
Give Senator Boni further 3 minutes.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, the housing levy, I was shocked. We were addressed by the CS National Treasury, who told us that they were contemplating investing the money collected from the housing levy into treasury bills, meaning that we got money from members of the public and we are unable to absorb it. It therefore teaches me that we should have collected less to meet our capacity to absorb. Instead of wiping people's pay slips, and now we are unable to use that money. Mr. Speaker, finally, things to do. Mr. President, dissolve cabinet, reconstitute it. Mr. President, disband offices outside the Constitution, including CAS, including Prime Cabinet Secretary. It is not in the Constitution of Kenya. Mr. Speaker, including offices of First Ladies, including, Mr. Speaker, advisors. If advisors are useful, then what David Ndii is doing is not advice, is misadvice. Mr. Speaker, the president should quickly restructure the security organs by firing people, the IG included. And finally, but not least, all the Sky teams must be grounded. I thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm on.